Tonight, I have the great pleasure of introducing to you Pauline Maier, talking about a very exciting subject with the title Ratification, the People Debate, the Constitution 1787-1788. This topic could not be more timely, not only because of what's happening in the United States, but what's happening across other parts of the globe, particularly in the Arab world, where reform is in the air, and people are trying to figure out their futures, and they're trying to figure out ways of doing their own constitutions. Pauline Maier is the William Rand Kinnon Jr. Professor of American History at MIT. She earned a PhD in history at Harvard in 1968, and is one of the world's preeminent scholars on the American Revolution and its heritage. She has published numerous articles and several books, including From Resistance to Revolution, American Radicals and the Development of Intercolonial Opposition to Britain, The Old Revolutionaries, Political Lives in the Age of Samuel Adams, and a junior high school textbook called The American People, A History, published in 1986. She's perhaps best known for American Scripture, making the Declaration of Independence, a fabulous book which I had the pleasure of reading at one time, which was on the New York Times Book Review Editor's Choice list of the 11 best books, fiction and nonfiction, of 1997. Her most recent book is Ratification, The People Debate the Constitution, 1787-1788, which was published last year. She did many other things besides, appeared on public television programs, documentaries, gave opinions on various constitutional matters, but we need an extra hour just to detail those activities. But in short, I am again delighted to introduce to you Professor Pauline Maier.
Thank you. Thank you. I am honored by the invitation to speak here, and it seems an extremely imaginative choice, I would say, to have me come and speak on the American Constitution for the instigation of this year's series by the Center for Global Humanities. I have never doubted that history is first and foremost a part of the humanities, not a social science. And if you were to look at the historical contributions that the United States has made to global culture, I think written constitutions has to be very high on that list. I'm not going to make a comparison with jazz. I will just say they're both on the list. The oldest written constitution in the world is that of Massachusetts of 1780, not the United States Constitution of 1787. And I think people in Maine can take some credit for that, since after all, Maine was still part of Massachusetts in 1780, and it was still part of Massachusetts when the U.S. Constitution had to be ratified in 1787 to 1788. Maine is part of my story. But the strange thing, I think, is that this story has not been told before. Now, let me be clear what this story is. The heart of this book begins when the Federal Convention adjourned on the 17th of September, 1787. And it looks at the next year, between then and, as it happened, September 13th, 1788, when the Confederation Congress declared the Constitution ratified. In the interim, the Constitution was submitted to popularly elected state conventions. And it was there that the Constitution's fate was decided. And my book looks at that process from state to state, looking at the conventions. I will confess there was a moment when, after I'd signed the contract to write this book, I went into total panic. I thought, oh my God, I have agreed to write a book on 13 constitutions debating the same subject that has to be deadly dull. Then I realized that a good part of mankind spends a good deal of their lives watching the same blank game played night after night, week after week. And it struck me that these conventions are rather the same. The joy of watching baseball night after night, to take a random sport, not too random these days, is that each game plays out slightly differently, right? not every fifth inning is like every other fifth inning, and the outcome is never entirely clear until the end. The conventions and the ratification process were exactly the same. I would say politics was our first national game, and here's the story. But there's no book that traced the story. I mean, I'm not saying historians had neglected the topic entirely. I'll talk about what they've done. But nobody laid out the story of ratification state by state by looking at the conventions where the Constitution's fate was decided. And the contrast with the Federal Convention, I think, is especially dramatic. We have shelves of books which tell the fascinating story of the 4 months in which the Federal, or if you prefer, the Philadelphia Convention met between May and September. And those books often have a final chapter or maybe an appendix and where they click off what happened, Delaware, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, down through the list. Occasionally, they might do more than just click off the list, but this is, you know, done quickly. At the end of a book on the Federal Convention, like the afterthought it was for those authors. It's as if the ratification of the Constitution was a no-brainer, and therefore not much of a story, so you should just get it out of the way and then go on with your life. But how could that be? Well, the way I understand it is that it is a response to the very reverential attitude toward the Constitution, which set in amazingly rapidly once it was ratified. Already in early 1789, Melanchthon Smith, one of my favorite characters in this book, commented with total bewilderment that there were people in New York City speaking of the Constitution as if it had been of divine origin. I mean, to him, it was so clear it was not of divine origin. That's where this attitude comes from. But if you go on the other side of that development, to the period I'm looking at, the reverence wasn't there. The Constitution was under fire. People were ripping it apart, attacking it, sometimes in language that would shock a contemporary member of the Tea Party. And some of the rest of us as well. But how could this be a non-story? Let me tell you a few things, and you'll see why this had to be. You know, a story with some drama. First of all, when the Federal Convention adjourned and announced that it had written a constitution, the country was shocked. It had no authority to write a constitution. It had been appointed, as the Federal Confederation Congress put it, for the sole and exclusive purpose of proposing amendments to the Articles of Confederation. So what did it do? It closed the doors, met in secret for 4 months, and said, hey, that Confederation, can it? And have we got an idea for you? Now, how could they do that? They didn't have any authority to do it. I have to emphasize that. Oh, they explained. The convention issued a letter, which George Washington signed, and it said that they had decided early on that they could not give new powers to the Confederation because those powers would have been exercised by only one institution. The Confederation had only a Congress. It was the executive, legislative, and judicial. So they said, for safety's sake, we had to design a new government so these powers would be split among legislative, executive, and judiciary. But I submit to you for the moment, the one institution which had most usurped unauthorized power was the Federal Convention itself. And in a country very sensitive about that issue, the unauthorized use of power, that particular fact would not go unnoticed. Second, exacerbate the problem, it decided it should say how this unauthorized constitution should be ratified. What the convention said was that it should be laid before Congress. Now, what do you suppose that would mean, laid before? Well, and then forwarded to the states, we should call for special elections of ratifying conventions, which would decide on the Constitution. Well, what did laid before meant? Well, what it meant is that this is not going to be like approving amendments to the Articles of Confederation, which required the Confederation Congress's approval. You know, we're going to sidestep that issue. And then they were supposed to get amendments to the Confederation, which needed unanimous consent of the states. Well, here too, the convention had another idea. Yes, there would be conventions, and that made some sense. Given American constitutional development, that is, we had come to understand by 1787 that constitutions were different than ordinary laws and more fundamental because they were direct acts of legislation by the people. They were drafted by conventions beginning in Massachusetts, 1780. And hey, remember, Maine was Massachusetts in 1780, and then submitted to the people in the towns for ratification. In a sense, that was a fundamental development in American constitutionalism that was to be continued. All right, but there's a problem here. The Constitution says the approval of 9 states would be sufficient, not unanimous consent. Well, what about the other 4? Were we going to have a disunited states and 4 other independent kingdoms floating around somewhere on the North American continent? This, again, did not seem to some the wisest idea in the world. And to compound the problem further, the Federal Convention said these wonderful state conventions couldn't propose any changes to the Constitution. I mean, George Mason said, hey, look, I mean, as a Virginia delegate, we have met in secret for 4 months doing something the country had no idea we were doing. We have no feedback. A constitution has to fit the needs and preferences of the people. The convention should be allowed to propose amendments, and then there should be a second convention, which will look over these amendments and adjust the Constitution to what it is the people want. Ah, no, the delegate said, that's a bad idea, we won't do that. He said one other thing, it is not nice, basically, to tell the sovereign people take this or nothing. His colleague Edmund Randolph, the governor of Virginia, who had been more instrumental than most people in getting the convention to meet, was so appalled, he said, well, then they'll just vote it down if they can't make any changes. And so Mason and Randolph didn't sign, and they were joined by Elbridge Gerry of Massachusetts. Now, moreover, in the final days, one supporter of the Constitution after another got set up and said, he had lots of problems with it too, but they'd support it. It was the best they could get. Nobody thought it was of divine origin. But if the convention was split, if 3 people who lasted to the end didn't sign, you can bet this ratification was not going to be a no-brainer. And it wasn't, and it certainly wasn't a no story. Through the year on which whose story I trace, the Constitution was the topic of the year. It was debated in homes, in taverns, on the street. It was a subject of riots here and there, and of course in the conventions. When the conventions met in state after state, they faced one compelling problem. Where could they find a hall big enough to accommodate not only the delegates, but the hordes of people who wanted to hear the debates? In Massachusetts, for example, we had the largest of any of the state ratifying conventions. Some 370 delegates were chosen by the towns of Massachusetts, which I keep saying included Maine because it's a really important component of this body of delegates. But they had to ended up with a church whose balconies could accommodate another 600 to 800 people. And when the vote came, as you'll hear, every square inch of the church was stuffed with people who wanted to witness the calling of the roll and the casting of votes. This was exciting. The newspapers were full of information, debate over the Constitution. One New Englander said that in his section of the country, our section of the country, of course, newspapers were in that year read more than the Bible, and that was saying something in New England. Why? Why all this excitement? Because there were big issues out there. Was the Constitution going to contribute to the ruin of the United States or to its salvation? Would it fulfill the revolution or undermine all that the Americans had fought for? And depending on how you answer those questions, you would hope that the Constitution be ratified or rejected. And which would be the case was by no means clear. The tension was intense. Well, if this is such an exciting story, why didn't somebody write my book decades ago, if not a century ago? And I will give you my take on that. For one thing, the sources are voluminous and they're widely scattered. If I were to set out in my Subaru and to try collecting them, I would have to go not only to the capitals of the original 13 states, but to all kinds of outlying libraries, which have, you know, the records kept by their delegate to the state convention. I think it's not too much to say that to collect all of the documents relevant to the ratification of the Constitution and to write up a book would probably take more than one professional life. And I am unaware that God is accepting applications from historians for second lives because they'd failed to finish their book. So historians have gone the wise way and done something else. We have strategies for dealing with this kind of issue. First of all, historians write on a workable part of a big topic. Now that I see there are lots of students here, if you're writing research papers, no doubt your professors are telling you this. No, you can't write your research paper on World War II. It's too big. Find some part of the subject where you can get into primary sources and say something interesting. I mean, the professional historians do precisely the same thing. Or you could write on the whole of it with very limited questions. And that would limit how much of the sources and documents you'd need to go through. And historians have done this. They want to know, was Charles Baird Bright? Who were the anti-federals? It limits the amount of work you need to do. And then there's always collaboration. There are two books in which a series of historians wrote different chapters on states. Well, great. You say, that's a solution. The trouble is, a lot of the story falls between the cracks between chapters, like how one state influenced which came together, and the overall thrust of the development somehow it is never conveyed. The whole is more than the sum of the parts. Well, there's another problem here, and that is with regard to the conventions, which have been, I think, probably more neglected than other parts of the ratification story. And that is, if you want to write the story of the conventions, you need to know what was said there, right? And there are problems with the recorded debates. I mean, the biggest problem is that many states do not have a record of their debates. Nobody bothered to take them down. This is just at the beginning of the period where it seemed important to record the debates in public bodies like legislatures or ratifying conventions. And of those that do exist, the states that have published debates, there are problems. James Hudson, the curator of manuscripts, or the head of the manuscript division, I guess that's a little different, at the Library of Congress had a very sober article in the Texas Law Review in 1986, just 25 years ago. He said there were lots of problems with these debates. First of all, we are beholden to the skill of the shorthand manner stenographers. I gather he said at the time it took 5 years to master this art, and none of these guys had been at it that long. So, you know, sometimes they missed a speech. Certainly they missed phrases. Occasionally they missed a day, and that could be a problem. And then, not only that, they were biased, and I think this is absolutely true, that there were Federalists who paid the shorthand men or stenographers, or who subsidize the publication of their debates. Well, why would they do that? They did it because they thought the Federalist speakers were so wonderful that they laid out arguments and gave an example to speakers in other states, and that they should know what was said by their guys in the convention. And this led to rather skewed reports of the debates. In Pennsylvania, which I think is the worst of the lot, the published debates include the speeches of only two major Federalists. It's as if they were arguing with themselves, you know. You would think nobody else was there except one critic of the Constitution interrupted one of the speakers and managed to get his name into the record. Others are much better. Massachusetts, I will confess, I exaggerate a bit. They did report speeches of everyone. But at one point, the fellow taking down the debates in Massachusetts said roughly the following, it's a day like every other day. The anti-Federalists made their usual trivial objections to the Constitution, and the Federalists answered them. I just can't go on taking this nonsense down day after day. And you start to wonder, what about the nonsense they did take down? I mean, how much can I rely on it? This is, needless to say, a problem of some significance. In the end, Hudson concluded that these debates were so bad that it would be impossible to discern from them the original understanding of the Constitution on the part of the ratifiers. Now, if this is bad news for legal originalists, it's very bad news for historians. We do not like to stake our reputation on a cracked cane. We're not going to lean on a bad source too hard. And I think that's probably one reason why my book wasn't written long ago. So how did I write it? There's been a revolution in the past 25 years. I'm not sure the significance of this has entirely sunk in, but it's a revolution of amazing importance, I think, for American history, law, culture. It has to do with a series of documents, a publishing project out of the University of Wisconsin, which is called, da-da, The Documentary History of the Ratification of the Constitution. You might not think this is the most exciting thing in the history of the United States, but I say it's right up there. What did they do? Well, first of all, they sent teams of editors into various states. They collated, they transcribed, they printed documents. And the most incredible change has to do with the conventions, because if you're dependent on just the published debates, well, then you're dependent on the published debates. But they collate the official journals, which are kind of bare bones records of the conventions. They're public documents. When they convened, what officers were appointed, what rules were adopted, when they debated what, and how it moved forward. Now, if you get a little bit of experience, you can tease a lot of information out of these. And I think I learned how to do that after a while. But they rarely tell you what was said. But they're very interesting. I mean, if they spend a lot of time on Article 1, and then they zip through Article 2 in an hour, you might kind of figure out there's some problems with Article 1 that interested the delegates, and you might even be able to be a little bit more refined on your surmises. But they took the journals, they took the debates, and then they collate them with a series of other documents, newspaper accounts, delegates' journals, notes taken by people up in those galleys who weren't delegates at all. Oh, private correspondence. You know, when it was a real question what was going to happen in the Massachusetts Convention, Rufus King and a few other people were writing Madison and New York back and forth. We get, and the other conventions have parallel private correspondence. So you can tell not only what was happening on the floor of the convention, but what was happening behind the doors and in the private negotiations. We have nothing like that for the Federal Convention because they were secret. So, you know, in a sense, the ratifying conventions end up being more fully documented than the Federal Convention. The documentary history, which I will henceforth refer to as the DHRC because documentary history of the ratification of the Constitution is rather a lot to say, a mouthful. The DHRC has now 21 volumes in print, 14 of which are dedicated to telling the story of ratification in individual states, and most of those were not published 25 years ago. They've come since Hudson wrote, and that's why I say they're such a revolution. They haven't covered all. They've covered 8 states. They have 5 still to go. But they've covered the major ones. There's 1 volume on Pennsylvania, 3 on Virginia, 4 on Massachusetts, a full 5 on New York. My contract said I was supposed to finish the book in 2004. Not a chance. I realize now that I absolutely had to have the 5th New York volume, which only appeared in 2009. And I just clearly didn't know what I was doing when I signed the contract. And when I learned, I was, oh my God, you know, there were a lot of these, oh Lord, how did I get into this moments along the way? Well, you might say, okay, this also helped my organizational strategy. Those of you think about this, if you're writing a narrative, that is a story, you need a clear storyline. It's kind of like a television show. How do you get a clear storyline for an event that happens in 13 places, sometimes simultaneously? I wondered about that, and I think some of the earlier efforts, and I feel a little, you know, self-serving by this, but I think there's a recognition among historians they were failed efforts to do something like the book I've written, stumbled in part on that organizational problem. I mean, God, one of them talks about the North Carolina Convention before Virginia. You can't do that. It met after Virginia, and it was influenced by Virginia. So, you know, chronology, this matters, and history is, to some extent, one damn thing after another. And you got to get the order right. Okay. Well, what about the 5 states that weren't in the series? Well, you know, I found I could get a tremendous amount of information. A good bit of it was printed in the 19th century, more than and then some at the time of the Constitutional Bicentennial. And then in here, I'm going to be talking too long, so I'm going to curtail this. I found I could look at the secondary sources where some of it was magnificent, and I had such help from fellow historians. I feel so blessed to be in the profession of which I am a member, where I could write to a colleague like Jerry Daniel, who is emeritus from Dartmouth, and was ahead of me in graduate school, and say, I asked a simple question. I knew there was a folder in the New Hampshire archives, and I didn't know if it was, you know, town votes or if it was bare bones delegate credentials. And the archivist seemed like a very nice chap. He pulled it out, but he looked at it, and he hadn't a clue what he was looking at. And I thought, Jerry, well, now. I emailed him. He's at the age where he might or might not do email, right? You know, he did email. And he said, don't worry. He didn't answer my question, come to think of it. He said, I'm going to send you stuff. It'll answer all your questions. Jerry shared his research with me. Jerry knows New Hampshire inside out. He knows it street by street, house by house. He knows in one town in the western part, who lived next to each other, where they came from, why they, not only that they hated each other, but why they hated each other, and how that fed into the political process that led to the fate, deciding the fate of the Constitution in New Hampshire. I could never, if God gave me 5 lives, have replicated that kind of local studies for all of the states that were involved. But Jerry volunteered to share his research with me. Some of it was printed to read what I wrote to make sure I got it right, because he said he wanted his very specialized research read into the big story. So he made me think I was doing him a favor, but I wasn't fooled. I knew he was doing me a favor. Okay, so the book got done with a lot of help from my friends, and so what? What's different? First of all, I think it does make a difference for American law. I am not going to talk about originalism here. It is more complicated than most of us recognize. As I started to look at it, I realized it has some similarity to medieval theology, which has never been my favorite subject. But suffice it to say that the original intent of Edwin Meese is not the original understanding of Antonin Scalia. So I will simply say that if anyone wants to know how people understood provisions of the Constitution in the 18th century, the ratification debates are an excellent source now that they've been rendered usable by the DHRC, and my book is a kind of a guide to where the good parts are. People say, but she shows there is so much controversy. There was no original understanding of the Constitution. But how often does a court case ask, well, what did the Constitution mean? They turn on provisions. And these conventions went through the Constitution provision by provision. Sometimes there was enormous controversy, parts people found objectionable. But at other times, the debates were really informational, where one delegate will say, and I hear I'm thinking again of the Massachusetts Convention in particular, why did they write the provision on habeas corpus in Article 1, Section 9 the way they did? Isn't the way it's written in the Massachusetts Constitution of 1780 far preferable? Then somebody would get up to answer, maybe a delegate, a person who had been at the Federal Convention, maybe a member of the Supreme Court of Massachusetts, and explain. They're beautiful explanations. But not always, they didn't always go over, so people could say, maybe that's what you think, but notice what it says. So you would see controversy, but I think this is a much more focused kind of debate and should be much more useful in law. And certainly, it's a far preferable source to the Federalist Papers, which is an icon in American history. And I don't know, students, have you read them in your courses? Could you keep awake? Do you like them? Right? I've had a horrible time teaching them. But you know why? What's the matter with the Federalist Papers? Well, what we don't, we see these are these great, we're supposed to respect this as if they too are of divine origin, but they're partisan. They were written to get the Constitution ratified in New York, where there was powerful opposition. They did not circulate very widely during the ratification debates. In fact, I don't think they even circulated very widely in New York State. I have some evidence that in the upper part of the state where the opposition was, they hardly knew about them. And certainly other states, you know, an occasional essay would be reproduced, but not the, the whole of the collection. Until I was, they didn't circulate until they were printed in book form in March and May 1788. And by then, the game was pretty well over. And I'm not, I find very, outside of the New York Convention, it is very difficult to document that speakers were particularly influenced by the Federalist Papers. And finally, the positions espoused by at least two of the writers were disavowed by them, and particularly by Hamilton within 10 years. There's a wonderful picture in the book I have of Madison and Hamilton taunting each other in the 1790s with passages from the Federalist Papers until Hamilton said, well, I don't believe that anymore. And some things he wrote, I'm not sure he ever believed. So I this is supposed to be our sacred text. I say go to the ratifying debates. They're much more eloquent, much more useful. So I think for law, this is of importance. I think it's certainly important for historical understanding, and here I'm going to be rather brief. The more I did this narrative, the more I understood the things I'd been teaching through an increasingly long career were highly suspect. They were taken out of the specialized studies that historians had undertaken when they didn't feel it was possible to do the whole thing. Where did I get suspicious? The whole terms. How do we talk about ratification debates? It's a fight between Federalists and Anti-Federalists. I'm a little slow. I was up to Massachusetts, I think it's the sixth state, when I suddenly realized the only people who are using the word Anti-Federalists are Federalists.
and that the people they're describing never use the term, huh, what's going on here? And after a while, I decided I was going to use no name for anybody that they didn't accept, unless it appeared in a quotation. Of course, I wouldn't edit my quotations. So if it appeared in a quotation, I'll use the word anti-federalist. Otherwise, I wouldn't use it unless the people accepted it. And that limited me to using the term anti-federalist to critics in the of the Constitution in the upper Hudson Valley of New York. Nowhere else did they accept the name. Where did the term come from? Well, it was a Federalist term. They called their, I do use Federalists. The Federalists invented it, and they called themselves that. But they called their opponents anti-federalists, and it was, as one of the people so designated in Pennsylvania said, a term of opprobrium. It was an attack. They said these anti-federalists are opposing the Constitution because they're state officials and they're afraid they're going to lose their job or they're going to lose money in one way or another, and they're thinking about their own interests, not the public good. I mean, none of that really checks out, but it was standard kind of rhetoric for 18th century politics. But the bottom line is it's what Federalists called those who seem to be at odds with their position. The other thing is that if you see convention debates, sometimes the newspapers, instead of saying yay and nay, would say Federalist, anti-Federalist. Well, most of the newspapers were owned by Federalists, so that made some sense. But that is reporting an outcome, and an outcome is not an input. If you want to understand the process by which the Constitution was ratified, you got to shake off these terms because there were more than two sides. And I won't go into detail here. If somebody's interested in it, there are many shades of opinion. Not even the Federalists were uniform. On the far end, they had people who really wanted a far more centralized government than the Constitution would have made. There are others more moderate, much more happy with the federal system. And on the other side, there are some that said, the whole thing is illegitimate. We should just keep the Confederation and increase its powers incrementally because it's much easier to give power than to take it away. Not a dumb position, not altogether dumb. They had a problem over because you could never get unanimous consent of the states, it seems, to an amendment to the Confederation. So it was not necessarily practical. Most of those who criticized the Constitution said, look, the country's in a bad way. This is a step forward. They were not, therefore, opposed to the Constitution, but they said we need some fixes, we need some amendments, and they should go into effect before it is put into force because only, as Patrick Henry said in Virginia, only an idiot signs a contract assuming he can change objectionable provisions later. If you wouldn't do that in your private affairs, why would you do it where the future of your country and the freedom of your country is at stake? Not a dumb position. My problem was after I studied all this, I thought everybody made sense. And there was, what you have to look at to understand the process is why people moved really toward the center from the far end. That those who said, forget the whole thing, said, oh, well, some amendments will fix it. But prior amendments, and a few said, we can live with amendments that will be adopted after the Constitution is ratified. That process of transformation is what got the Constitution ratified. So to say, why the anti-federalist loss is, why did it to ask, is to ask the wrong question. That the terms dictate a wrong approach. And also it leads to other dichotomies. It assumes there were parties, there weren't parties, and that one was for and one was against, as you see now. That's not true. The other great thing I came to question has to do with the Bill of Rights. You know, there's a kind of a truism out there, you know, let's be nice to all sides. The Federalists gave us the Constitution, and the Anti-Federalists gave us the Bill of Rights. I will confess that the Bill of Rights, the lack of a Bill of Rights in the Constitution was a big issue in the ratification debates everywhere. But of the five states that ratified the Constitution, but connected with their ratification, a recommendation of a list of amendments to be adopted once the Constitution went into effect. Only one state, Virginia, formally asked that a Bill of Rights be added to the Constitution. The recommendations did have to do with rights, but the rights that the ratifiers had in mind are not necessarily the rights on the top of our minds. The 18th century was, after all, a while ago. They were concerned with rights, but the rights, the number one rights was, had to do with representation and taxation. You remember something about no taxation without representation? Basically, they said the provisions on representation weren't very good, that instead of saying there shall be no more than one member of the House of Representatives for every 30,000 people, can you get your head around that? What is that? There shall be no more than one for every, it means you could make it worse, you couldn't make it better. It should say, there shall be one representative for every 30,000 until the House reaches a certain size, and then give a procedure for prorating representation later. Not a dumb question, not a bad objection. And if representation was flawed, and remember the first House of Representatives would have had only 65 members if everybody showed up. Look, Massachusetts, you know, if all the towns chose as many representatives as they could have, the size of our lower house of assembly in the 18th century would have been between 350 and 400 people. So what kind of representation? 65 people for a country of 3 million, that's not representation. Well, then what's the problem? They said, well, then they shouldn't have the wall-to-wall taxing power in Article 1, Section 8. Now, this starts to feel kind of familiar. Basically, what they were concerned with were direct taxes, taxes you couldn't get away from, like real estate taxes and poll taxes. And they said if those would have to be allocated among the states according to population, states should be allowed to choose how they could fulfill that levy in any way that suited the circumstances of their people. And if a state did this, then the feds couldn't come in and collect the states. And this basically, to make a long story short, drew Federalists like Madison and Washington bananas. The whole purpose of the Constitution, they said, was to achieve fiscal responsibility, to impress creditors with fiscal responsibility of the United States, with the fact that Congress could collect money to pay off its loans. Look, at the point the United States was bankrupt, it had defaulted on, it starts to sound kind of contemporary, doesn't it? It just defaulted on an interest payment for France. It was paying off its Dutch loan by borrowing more money to pay off the loan. It was a kind of a Ponzi scheme. Look, it was altogether embarrassing. And they said, this is going to ruin everything. So, to make a long story short, Madison proposed in the first Congress, Madison, who said forever, we don't need to amend this Constitution, brought in the amendments. Why? Well, he was quite clear about what he was doing. He wanted to affirm the great rights of mankind so he could draw support off for the calling of a second amendment, a second convention would almost surely propose the tax amendment because every state that recommended amendments proposed the tax amendment. So in a way, maybe the anti-federalists got us the Bill of Rights, but it wasn't what they wanted. It was a way to get around the rights issue that was most important to them. And what I've discovered is that nobody in the 18th century called either the 12 amendments that Congress proposed in September 1789 or the 10 that were approved by December 1791 a Bill of Rights. Not Washington, not Jefferson, the great advocate of Bill of Rights, in announcing their ratification in February 1792. It became his task as Secretary of State to do that. So the story of the Bill of Rights is a long story. In fact, it appears no member of the Supreme Court referred to the first 10 amendments as a Bill of Rights in the late 19th century. Akhil Reed Amar at Yale Law School even quotes some federal judge in the 1880s saying, unlike many modern constitutions, our federal constitution doesn't have a Bill of Rights. This is by and large, a story that begins in 1868 with the 14th Amendment is carried on in courts in the 20th century. The first appearance of this is the Freedom Train in 1947 of the Bill of Rights with the Declaration and the Constitution. So that's another story. Okay, this is what's new. But, you know, I am inclined to say that a good story is its own excuse and its own justification. And from the opening round in Pennsylvania, the opening round of the ratification debates, where the Constitution supporters almost blew it, through the game-saving strategy of Massachusetts, the New Hampshire Convention's heart-stopping decision to adjourn in February 1788 without voting, Patrick Henry's game-stealing performance at the Virginia Convention in Richmond, the cliffhanger New York Convention in Poughkeepsie, and North Carolina's stubborn no even after the unamended Constitution had more than the 9 required state votes to go into effect. The story from ratification is a tremendous story, and it has some of the most wonderful moments. The chapters I think I like the most are those on Massachusetts. I think that they're those that I am most proud of, in part because I could frame the story with the trip of a Maine person, Dummer Sewell, who went from Bath, Maine to Boston, and then, of course, went home again and kept a journal. I mean, what does it take to drive from Bath to Boston? Hour and a half, 2 hours? Well, something like that. It took him 6 days. And he tells what he did along the way. He had to go to a ferry. He had to wait for the ferry. He had to take a bridge. Horse is on a horse. Wouldn't you know, he got to Danvers, old witch territory, and the weather got wicked. And he had to go for cover. And then before going into Boston, and he never tells how he did the last lap, and I'm still wondering, he had to find somebody who'd take care of his horse while he was at the convention. I say, it makes looking for a parking place in Boston seem like child's play. And then when the convention met, there were a lot of nose counters trying to figure out what had happened in the towns, but the state and Maine, too, were deeply divided on this issue. And so there was strategies. The Federalists didn't want to call a vote till they knew how the vote would go. So they said we will have a conversation, not a debate, a conversation on the Constitution, because if you're having a conversation, how often do you stop and say, okay, now we'll vote? They wanted no votes till they knew how the vote would go. And they really assumed that the Federalists, who had all of the educated people of practiced eloquence, could talk those country bumpkins into it. And you know, they couldn't. And finally, they realized they couldn't, and they had to cut a deal to recommend amendments. This is where that whole process began. And then, in order to get it through, they realized they were going to need the support of John Hancock. Hancock was a very popular governor. He had been elected a Boston delegate. He had then been elected president of the convention, but he hadn't attended because he was suffering from gout. And there were those that said, as soon as it was clear how the political wind was blowing, his gout would get better very quickly. But it still wasn't quite clear, so they had to cut a deal with him. They made certain promises, and and then he made his dramatic appearance. And this is my editor's favorite moment in the whole book. He said, it has to be downhill from here, when they carry John Hancock into the convention wrapped in flannel, which is a cloth which mixes, it was 18th century cotton and wool. I mean, basically, he was swathed in bandages as they carried him in. He couldn't walk, or he said he couldn't walk, and they carried him in. And it's still the tension with Maine. Oh, I promised in Little Promise say why the Maine delegates were so important. Well, the Federalists said the Maine delegates were against the Constitution because they thought it would interfere with their getting separate statehood. I have never found it. That's another bit of Federalist calumny, best I can figure. I have never found any Maine town that expressed anything of that sort, or a Maine delegate who expressed anything of that sort, where they articulated why they had reservations on the Constitution. It was pretty much the same as what other people in other parts of Massachusetts said. Well, what is this? 6-year terms for senators. I mean, everybody had annual elections, had to come up before the voters every year in Massachusetts. This was outrageous. The taxes, it was the same as everywhere else. I mean, Maine was part of the United States. And when the vote came, finally, the tension was so great. I love this. I'm not going to read the passage. I've already talked too long. But you have to imagine this church on Long Lane stuffed. They knew the vote was going to be in the afternoon. People went for dinner in the midday, but people wouldn't leave. They'd lose their seat. They sent some boy out to bring them a piece of cheese and gingerbread or something. And they sat there and waited. And finally, by the time the vote was taken around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the galleries were stuffed. And something called the cellar, which turns out not to be the basement, it's kind of like a mezzanine. To put it briefly, every square inch in the hall was stuffed with people. But those who describe it say it was so quiet you could hear a coin drop. Everybody wanted to hear as the vote was taken, so the only sound was the clerk calling out the names and the response, yay or nay. And you could just see people saying, oh, I thought he was voting the other way. You know, because it was everybody was there because they didn't know how it was going to go. And in the end, of the 370 people who had been elected, there were 364 who attended. 9 did not vote. It could be they were sick, but I think that was a bit of cowardice, actually. They didn't want to vote the way their towns wanted them to vote, so they just hid under the bed. So the vote was 187 to 169 with 9 absentees. Massachusetts had ratified in this enormous convention with a margin of 19 votes. And once this was announced, within not too long a time, the bells all through Boston started to toll because Boston was strongly in favor of the Constitution. And I think the contrast between the silence in the hall and the tolling of the bells, it gets me choked up just thinking about it. While we're at it, how did Maine do? It voted 25 to 21 in favor. That's roughly, I just did a little calculation before, that's roughly the split in the state as a whole. Maine was like everybody else. They didn't have any bias against the Constitution. See, it was calumny. Okay, then there were all the characters. Maybe I shouldn't go through this. Some of you have heard of James Wilson of Pennsylvania. But he had a wonderful opponent, a guy named William Findlay, an Irish immigrant. No, how many people have heard of him? Or a young Massachusetts lawyer from Andover, William Symes, who dared to question his old law teacher, the formidable Theophilus Parsons. Francis Dana was our first minister to Russia, whose oratory left the throng. Forget these people. His oratory left the throngs in the convention in Boston and even some reporters absolutely spellbound. The reporters forgot to take notes while they're, oh, my God, what oratory. Jonathan Smith is a farmer from Western Massachusetts whose heartfelt endorsement of the Constitution based on the terrifying experiences he had had during Shays' Rebellion came at exactly the right moment. Or Zachariah Johnston, whom one observer called the best speaker at the Virginia Convention, better, it seems, than even Patrick Henry or James Madison. And Jefferson said Jefferson, who hated Henry, hated him so much that he was bad-mouthing him to his descendants decades after Henry was in his graves. That's not nice. Better than Henry or I was personally awed by James Iredell's probing analysis of the Constitution in North Carolina's first convention. It had two. And also thought his leading opponent, Judge Samuel Spence, was uncommonly good. And then there was Melancton Smith in New York, without whose efforts that state undoubtedly would have refused to ratify, and his friend from Massachusetts, Congressman Nathan Dane, who sent Smith some of the wisest, most statesmanlike political counsel I have ever encountered. That there are such men is significant. It shows that the country was not dependent on a handful of great men. The United States had a deep bench. That's not to say Washington wasn't dispensable, or Hamilton wasn't brilliant, or Madison wasn't learned. In the end, however, there were others who might have moved forward into national office and sometimes did, but who often spent their political lives within their states. They and their constituents, a very important part of the story, invested their minds and their hearts in evaluating the Constitution and its probable impact on what they repeatedly called millions yet unborn. That in the end, they supported ratification is only part of their gifts to this country. As I say in the book, they made the Republic work. It was very satisfying to be able to give them finally the place in American history that they had earned so long ago. It felt like an act of historical justice long overdue. And I think they probably have a great deal more to say to us. They give an example of activist citizenship. The ratification story is a story of the democratic component in the creation of the Constitution. And I think it's probably exactly what the country needs now. Thank you.
We have about 20 minutes for a question and answer session.
Fine.
Nobody can ask a question without a microphone. Microphones will be on both sides of the room. And so that's how we're going to do it.
Just shout it out, right? You need it for the recording, right?
Thank you so much for coming. I have two really quick questions. One, you said there were 12 rights, but only 10 got ratified.
Yes.
I'm wondering what the two that didn't make it were.
Oh, very good. Well, Congress recommended 12, and the country obviously enacted 10. The first had to do with representation, but it didn't assert a principle that the people have a right to a full and free representation in Congress. That probably would have been good, would have been acceptable. But instead, it tried to give the formula that the Constitution should have said. And there were those who looked at the numbers and said they weren't going to work, that at certain points as the population grew, representation would actually decline. So it was a question whether the implementation plan was sensible. And it didn't look like a rights principle. And the second is what we have today, actually, is the 27th Amendment. Oh. It's a restriction on Congress voting itself, a raise until there is an intervening senatorial, election for the House of Representatives. You don't have to wait 6 years. It's just 2 years. Yeah.
And second, quickly, you said that there were some people who said, we have to get this passed quickly, or at least some of the amendments, because there are problems going on in the country that need to be addressed immediately,
right,
and the country was in trouble. I'm just wondering what those
were. Well, I think you get that more from the Federalists. The Federalists seem to me in deep panic. I mean, I quote in the beginning, or the end, I should say, of I think the second or third chapter, a statement from Hamilton, which is like many other people were saying. They said, if it isn't ratified, there'll be civil war, there'll be chaos, the country's going to fall apart, we might go back under Britain. I mean, this is, and Washington had the same, well, except this was a private menu. And Washington was saying this kind of thing to Madison. Personally, I see no evidence for it. And actually, many of people like Henry said, what's the problem? The country's perfectly peaceful. And they say, well, did you hear about Shay's Rebellion? He says, we haven't had it in Virginia. Well, it maybe not have been true. And Shay's Rebellion was over and was actually put down quite easily despite the panicked fears of people like Henry Knox. I think the people of the country are fundamentally loyal. They had fought for the revolution. They wanted it to succeed. I think the panic was unjustified, but it did exist. And I think they were terrified, actually, but, well, Shays' Rebellion is part of it, but there were uprisings in New Hampshire, and there had been similar uprisings in other places. This, incidentally, was a response to the heavy state taxation, trying to pay off the Revolutionary War debt. You know what it ended? When Hamilton took over the state debts, he managed to cut the tax obligations of the states by as much as 90%. As much as 90% of a state's annual budget was allocated to paying off the revolutionary debt. Well, if the feds were going to do it, the states didn't have to levy those taxes. What it is fund the debt, didn't have to pay the principal right away, paid off the interest with import duties and a whiskey tax, which turned out to be not too popular in Western Pennsylvania, but then, yeah.
I haven't read your book, I'm sorry to say. However, I've read some
Look at the joy you have ahead of you, right?
But in the reviews I've read about it, there's an intimation, I guess my question is, did you see any socioeconomic patterns in terms of, not Beardian, that crew,
no.
But connections between, connections to the Atlantic economy as opposed to subsistence,
right.
Any of that?
Well, where people say there's no analysis in the book, what they really mean is that I didn't argue that there were socioeconomic differences, mainly because I don't think there were in a dramatic way. Yes, inland people tended to be suspicious of the Constitution, and people along the coast tended to be in favor of it. Now, there's much greater wealth along the coast. I mean, you have merchants, you have... you know, mercantile wealth. Why should this be? I think the explanation is kind of simple, that people in cities and other commercial centers thought that the Constitution was really going to be terrifically good for the American economy, that if we had a strong national government, that our shippers would, you know, be able to get back into business and the commercial depression of the 1780s would be over. They may have said, this is good for us, but my guess, they also said it's good for the country, and they were right, because the commercial prosperity of the 1790s was good for the country as a whole. But people in the interior, I think, without that particular consideration, were more concerned with what would happen to the rights that they'd fought for in the revolution. A lot of blood had been spilled. And if they're giving in on representation and taxation, to take a random example, or if they're passing a constitution that doesn't have any strong statement that standing armies in time of peace are a danger to liberty, and that was an old Anglo-American liberal principle, you know, they looked at this and they wrinkled their brow. They wanted what they fought for in the revolution very securely protected. Now, those along the coast weren't against it, but I think there's a balance of sentiment, but there's also a common interest in the good of the country. And some people changed their mind over the course of the debates. They decided, at first they were very suspicious, and then they decided, I guess it'll be okay, and we need it, we can go for it, we can make what changes we need later. I don't think there's a profound socioeconomic difference. There's a geographical difference, which sometimes has certain economic... To be wealthy in Western Massachusetts is to be a lot poorer than to be wealthy in Boston. But, you know, these places had their own social hierarchies, too. And, I'm just very suspicious of anything that even sniffs of economic determinism. I think the debates are much more complicated than that. Yeah. Yeah.
There's much debate about... states' rights, particularly the provision that 9 states were sufficient to force the other 4 into...
Well, they didn't, because if those 9 states who voted yes, that was sufficient to put the Constitution into effect, but only over the states who had voted yes. So there was a real possibility at one point that after New Hampshire ratified, that the United States would continue, except it would not include Rhode Island, New York, Virginia, North Carolina, And one other state, right, or I'm missing, that's four. That's four, I'm right. 9 and 3 left over. Well, Rhode Island you could forget. I mean, it's a puny little place, and you could send the army in and divide it between Connecticut and Massachusetts. But a country without New York, and Virginia, North Carolina, remember, included what is now Tennessee, Kentucky, and West Virginia. They went from the Atlantic to the Mississippi. It would be a really weird-looking country. It would be the disjointed snake. So could it have survived? That was an issue. It really was an issue. Yeah. So they didn't, you know, they didn't question that particularly. There were some people knitting their brow over it, but it wasn't a big issue. Strangely, they accepted it as a rule of thumb for gauging when it was the Constitution was ratified. Yeah. Yes.
I have a couple questions. What was it about the Constitution that inspired you to write such a well-documented book, and or why did you agree to write it?
I say with some humility, it wasn't my idea. I got a call one day, I remember very dramatically, I was sitting in my office at MIT, and I have an agent. This sounds so fancy, a literary agent. It's an old college colleague. And told me that an editor from Simon & Schuster had called her agency because they handled a lot of American historians. That I like. It makes us sound like racehorses, doesn't it? And so she called me. This is, an exercise of friendship, and said there's this editor at Simon & Schuster who has discovered there is no good book on the ratification of the Constitution. He's looking for an American historian to write one, and it took me like 20 seconds to say, I'll do it! I'm not sure she even got to finish her sentence. Now, why did I say it so quickly? In retrospect, for several reasons. American scripture making the Declaration of Independence was a successful book, but afterwards, I met David McCullough, who said, oh, yeah, good book. He says, of course, I don't do anything like that. He says, I tell stories. And I thought, I thought I was telling a story in American scripture, and I thought, I want to write a book where I tell a story. And so a narrative history, that appealed to me. And then I knew that these documentary history, the ratification of the Constitution is being ratified. I'd used parts of it, and they were marvelous documents. I think my comparative advantage in history is in reading documents. I mean, I'm a good reader of documents. I say this modestly. But hey, this saved me the trouble of going around from archives collecting them. I could just sit there and read them and write up the book. And so it was beautiful. And then there's one other reason that's a little silly. After I wrote American Scripture, people used to come up to me, and I mean, people like the girl who collected books from the office where I was working in the Harvard College Library through a lawyer on a subway, and they would say to you, oh, you're the lady who wrote the book on the Constitution. And I would say to them, well, actually, it's on the Declaration of Independence. And they would go, another tedious academic drawing all these fine lines. And I thought, maybe I'll be the lady who wrote the book on the Constitution. And then if somebody says, oh, you're the lady that wrote the Declaration of Independence, book on the Declaration, I can say yes. If, they'd both be right. I wouldn't have to feel I had to correct anybody and get this response.
Thanks for a great insight into this ratification process. Sounded a little bit like we have similar circumstances with the media back then as we have now with respect to presenting just all the things, just taking extreme sides. Was that correct?
I suppose they're looking. I mean, now sure. Yeah, and so much never gets in the news. The problem we had then was that the newspapers were controlled by the Federalists. I'm not so sure that they were, looking for extreme stories. There was more of a real political bias in there. In fact, there's quite a bit in the book that talks about freedom of the press. I mean, we have our ideas of freedom of the press, and I think actually we get all different perspectives quite well. I mean, if there's a presidential debate, serious candidates, or a gubernatorial debate, all serious contenders, and however you measure serious contenders, have to be participants. So that's not a problem. But in the 18th century, you know, a newspaper could present only one side of the story and just suppress the rest. Federalist papers were doing that. To get an essay that attacked or even moderately criticized the Constitution into print was not the easiest thing in the world. We owe a tremendous amount to a couple of really stubborn characters. My favorite is a guy named, was it Eliezer Oswald in Pennsylvania, some Brit. I mean, he was an Englishman who came over here. He was a stubborn cuss. And he'd printed some criticisms of the Constitution, and most of his clients were Federalists. And they said, "You can't print us that." He says, "No one tells me when I can print." They said, "We'll cancel our subscription." He says, "Cancel, but pay your bill first." And he became a major printer of these, and then some other papers would pick them up, but it was very hard. Connecticut, they suppressed almost all criticisms of the Constitution. There was no real, media debate in Connecticut. We live in a period where you can get much more of a diversity of views on issues if you make the effort. Yeah. Of course, the internet changes all of this, right? Everything's available.
Hey, thanks for the presentation. And I just have a couple questions.
Good.
First is, with a book, you have to leave some things out when you're editing. What was your main things that you kind of wanted to include in the book, but you couldn't like afford it or like have time to put in?
You know, not really. I tried to write it reasonably concisely because I wanted, it to be a readable book. The choice I had to make was how much detail could I include without turning off general readers and still serve jurists who are going to be using this book, I hope, to figure out where certain debate issues were debated and when, because they can use my book to figure out where in the DHRC the good parts are. But I wasn't constrained all that much. I was really a bit surprised on that. I thought my editor was going to say, "Oh, this is way too long, cut it down." And he didn't. And he let me have the notes, too. At one point, he wanted those awful blind notes, so maybe people here will love them. So there's no numbers in the text. And then there's supposed to be a little phrase at the end that tells you what's being footnoted. Why? You tell me, what's wrong with numbers in the text? You don't have to pay attention to them. Can't you filter them out? Look, I spend my life filtering out bad music as I walk through the world. Can't you just filter out numbers in a text? And if we have more educated people, shouldn't educated people ask themselves when they read something that seems questionable, why did she or he say that? And in order to answer that question, you have to look at a note. I do not assign my students historical works that don't have notes because I'm trying to teach them to be discriminating in what they believe of what they read. In any case, I said I wouldn't change them, and he didn't say, "Well, then we won't publish your book." So anyway, he'd waited a very long time for it. And I think maybe I policed myself to some extent. But writing narrative needs air. Narrative needs space. And historians are trained to ask questions and then gather material. Writing narrative, it's different. At a certain point, I would say, "Oh, I thought I'd have one chapter on the Massachusetts Convention. Well, this is getting a little long. Oh, here's a logical breaking place. I'll start another chapter." And it worked. It was fun. It was such fun writing this. Yeah.
Hi. I have a quick question. You said there was five...
Where are you? Oh, there. Okay.
You said there were five books that have not been published yet. that compiled all the information from like certain states?
Oh, five states, which has not yet been covered by the documentary history of the ratification of the Constitution.
Okay, did you want to write a brief sequel to this book to include?
Well, I have covered those states. As I said, I gave most space to the four big states, to Pennsylvania, Massachusetts, Virginia, and New York, and folded the others in. Maybe I didn't say that. Folded them in at the appropriate place chronologically. And there I got, you know, I used what materials I could get, and I used this, I was much more dependent on secondary sources than I otherwise would have been, and on friends, people like my friend Jerry Daniel. I am a little bit on pins and needles as those, to see if what I said was right. I'm not so worried about New Hampshire because nobody knows as much about New Hampshire as Jerry Daniel, and he read what I said on New Hampshire. I was a little worried about Rhode Island when I discovered that they are publishing three volumes on Rhode Island, as much as Virginia, and there are no records of the debates in Rhode Island. But the secondary sources I used were by John Kaminsky and Pat Conley, and they are editing these volumes. And I did see Pat once in Rhode Island, and I said, well, Pat, trying to look cool as a cucumber, tell me, did you find anything that surprised you and that's different than what you've written about ratification of the Constitution in Rhode Island? He said, not really. And I went, whew. But, you know, there may be some surprises in future volumes. Look, ideally, this is the way, if you think about it in an idealized way, this is the way historical progress should be achieved. There should be, early after an event, a fast and dirty narrative, right? And then people take it apart here and there until finally your fast and dirty narrative no longer makes sense anymore. And then somebody gathers up all the specialized scholarship, corrects the story, writes an up-to-date narrative, and then people start taking it apart. We waited 220-some years for a first narrative. This seems to me the process has begun. This narrative will take a while till somebody writes another book that does what I did. And Gordon Wood, in a little blurb on the back, says it seems unlikely anybody will do it, but I'm not so convinced. It'll take a while. But, you know, not everything I said is going to hold up. It was my best shot based on the material I had. And, you know, some historians are going to start saying, yeah, I don't believe that. And maybe they'll find better evidence than I found. That's the way it should work. I'm not God. And I've never had any illusion in that regard. Right.
I had a question. You said earlier in states such as Virginia that the debates were held behind more or less closed doors.
No. Only the federal convention in Philadelphia that wrote the Constitution. You could not exclude people from the ratifying conventions because they were speaking on behalf of the people.
So, well, I was going to ask, why would they exclude people in the first
place? They could not. And they did not.
Oh, but I mean at the
federal one. Yeah, that's why people were crowding in to hear them, because they knew they were very important. And also, of course, they had great orators, and orators were the rock stars of the day, the great speakers. And I think they were very dramatic. The federal convention. They just did. They locked the doors, they shut the windows, they pulled down the blinds, and they went at it and decided they would not let anybody carry any paper out of the convention. They weren't to write, they weren't to talk about the convention. There was one time somebody brought in a piece of paper that somebody had casually left around, I think was probably a vote that they had looked at, you know, carefully, and said, to whom does this belong? And I think George Washington, this is some, you don't say to George Washington, oh, I'm sorry, I was a little sloppy with the rules, wasn't I? Nobody. And you need to do that once, and nobody's going to do it. Some information did filter out, but nothing that got into the public stream or that's been recorded. There just are some people that seem to know more than they should have known.
Hi, I also had a question. It seemed that many opposers to the Constitution found inherent flaws within the text of the Constitution, and that seemed to power or fuel most of the debates.
Yes.
After years of provisions and amendments to the Constitution to where we are today, what flaws do you see still translated in today's biggest political issues?
Well, the presidential elections are the if I were going to go around changing things, I'd change them. Right. That's where I'd start. If you know, I think this is the biggest mistake. Why do we have the Constitution does not use the words electoral college. Obviously, the system that was laid out didn't work, which is why we got the 12th Amendment, revising it very quickly after the election of 1800. But it still doesn't quite work. I mean, we wouldn't have had the election of 2000, all that problem with, you know. What would I change? Well, you know, here's the question. The obvious thing, what's the simplest way to elect the president? Direct popular vote, right? I mean, this is a no-brainer. It's so simple. Why didn't they do it? Well, George Mason said in the convention that to submit a choice of the president to the people would be like submitting a choice of color to a test of color to a blind man. He thought the people didn't know anything. Look, that ended so quickly. As soon as the Post Office Act let newspapers be sent, you know, I don't know, very cheaply or free through the country, became clear people, even in remote parts of the country, knew more about our politics than people. Well, in 1830, there was a guy that said people in Michigan Territory knew more about national politics than people in the distant parts of metropolitan Paris knew about French politics. Information very quickly got disseminated, and today we have the internet. Do we have an information problem? I haven't noticed it. If I have the information problem, maybe we have too much information, but the people are not ignorant. At least those who want to know can know. So that's not a problem. But there's another. Look, the whole system smells bad when you start looking at it. I mean, it's got a corrupt strain through it. What did it do? Think about it. Where do you think people could vote the most in the 18th century? Where was the greatest number of voters? Cities and in the north. Consider in the southern states, well, first of all, slaves can't vote, right? And places like South Carolina were very poorly misappropriated. The seats were poorly appropriated. That country really didn't have enough representation, et cetera, et cetera. If everybody voted, the North would win all the time. So this was a real problem. What the system did was to allow a state to have a set number of votes, even if nobody voted, right? And of course, the votes for the southern states were pumped up by the 3/5 of their slaves. And after the Civil War, of course, 100% of their black population, even if they couldn't vote, as they couldn't by later in the century when there was all this disenfranchisement. Look, it just smells bad. It meant that the white elite could vote for all of the population in the South, even if they wouldn't let them vote. We haven't had a slave in this country for a long time. I think it's time we go back to a more democratic system of a more democratic system of electing the president. That's what I think. That's my number one problem. I don't think it's very hard to amend the Constitution, and I can't decide if that's good or bad. The net effect. Look, we've got 27 amendments, but 11 of those were passed by 1791. In the past 220 years, we've had seven, 17, but one cancels out another. It's prohibition and ending prohibition. So a net of 15 amendments in 220 years. It's too hard. I think it's too hard. You need a 2/3 vote of Congress or a convention in 3/4 of the states. Was the Equal Rights Amendment a good idea? Yeah. But it couldn't be passed. I think it's too hard. And what has been the net effect? The net effect is that the adapting of the Constitution to historical change has ended up
in the courts. That was never anticipated. I think what the founders assumed, they never thought they certainly did not assume that they'd written the Constitution for all time. They assumed it would be adapted to changing circumstances by the amendment process until that became had diminishing returns. And then they would just write another Constitution that would be more suited to a very different time they couldn't imagine. The states, one state after another, had replaced their original state constitutions. I think by 1790 or so, you had several states on their third constitutions. I mean, you know, if it doesn't work anymore, you write a better one. It's an experimental process. Well, we didn't do that. We've got the same constitution, and it's the court that's doing it, and that's a very clunky, undemocratic process. And then there's Congress. How do we get rid of all those rules which undermine good sense and representativeness? Yeah, I'm sorry. Here I go. You shouldn't have got me going on that. Yeah, right.
What aspect of your research did you spend the most time on while writing your book?
Trying to figure out what I was doing, I think. I couldn't figure. I mean, I spent a lot of time Then all of a sudden I realized what I was doing, and then all I needed was time. And I'm very blessed at being at a wonderful institution, MIT, that believes in research. And I had a sabbatical, and it was about 3 years after a sabbatical, and I was ready to write. I had chaired a big committee looking for a dean of my school. And I said to the provost who appointed me, look, if I'm going to chair this committee, I can't go asking for favors from any dean or even, interim dean, because the interim dean was a candidate for the deanship. I said, I've applied for a grant. If I get it, I was going to go to the dean and ask for supplementary funding. But now I'm going to come to you. And he smiled. And after all this was done, he said, you did a great job on that committee. If you ever need anything, come see me. And I said, you'd be sorry you said that. And in the end, he managed to supplement the National Endowment for the Humanities grant. So I had a full academic year to write with the two adjoining summers. And most of the book was written. Over half of the book was written in that period. It was, once you're ready to go, it moves. Until you know what you're doing, it takes forever. I spent forever writing the prologue, which is sort of the background to the Constitution. And the early chapters seemed like pulling teeth because I wanted to get into the conventions. And then actually your question, I kept feeling I had to cut those back because it was taking too long to get into the action. But that was a narrative problem.
Pauline, yeah. We have a number of people watching us online. Ah. And we got a question from Tangier, Morocco, which we'll be projecting on the screen.
My goodness.
There it is. It's behind you.
Oh. How did the delegates get a constitution that was between those who wanted tremendous power, am I summarizing this correctly, and those who wanted a very weak central government? That is a terrific question. Those who wanted, well, there was compromise all along the line. There were a good number of people in the Federal Convention who really thought the country needed an immensely centralized government, and Hamilton continued to believe that. Others did not and favored the Confederation, of course, was very much state-centered rather than central-centered. In fact, what we got was a government that was between them. Many of the people who were concerned in the ratification debates with the Constitution were afraid it would destroy the states altogether. And again, the taxation business came in there because there was no tax allocated for the use of the states. So they thought, they're just going to seem redundant. How did they come up? Does the Constitution itself come out between these two? I think maybe it does, because it gives some assurances for the continuation of the state. I think probably the compromises are worked out far more in the Federal Convention than in the ratifying debates. And we do have certain things which, as the Federalists could say, would allow the continuation of the states. The states' legislatures elected the Senate. They said you really, the state legislatures chose how members of the Electoral College, and this really limited the amount that the central government could do. But I think it was worked out in the convention under the pressure of necessity that a highly centralized government would never be ratified. So compromises had to be made, and they understood that. Yeah.
Anybody else?
During the ratification process, I was wondering if you found harbingers of the Civil War in the debates, and were they regionally based? That sort of could foretell the future.
Yeah, well, the red herring always was that there are going to be secessionist movements, and that somebody wants to form a Southern Confederacy. But I don't think that was actually the case. Where you might look for harbingers would be in divisive fights over, well, we would say slavery. But where they're sectionally based fights, they weren't so much over slavery. I mean, there was some of that. In the Virginia Convention, Patrick Henry said, you ratify this, they're going to free your slaves. But this fellow, Zachariah Johnston, I mentioned, got up and said, that'd be a good thing. It's a terrible institution. George Mason in the Virginia Convention is wonderful on this because we think, oh, Southern, they must have really rallied to defend the slave system. They did not. Mason said, he was really upset they were going to allow the slave trade to continue for 20 years because he said this is poisoning the republic. And Madison said we got a good deal. He said we had that was the cost of keeping South Carolina and Georgia in the Union. So we get South Carolina and Georgia forever, and we get rid of the slave trade after 20 years. There was no hope of ending the slave trade under the Confederation, but now there's a chance of getting rid of it. Well, did we have South Carolina and Georgia forever? After this. Mason said, you should have let them go. And this is the counterfactual, proposition, which intrigues me. I mean, those questions you can never answer. What if they'd said, go? If that's the cost of keeping in the Union, just go. It would have prevented a certain amount of unpleasantness in the 1860s. And how would they have developed? Probably developed. The whole history would have certainly looked a lot. But the answer, in general, I don't see a lot of harbingers. What I see in the Virginia debates was an argument on how much the Southern states need the Northern states. For example, in the Revolutionary War, they said, we needed them. We needed them to protect us. We have militias, but we also have slaves, and that's kind of scary. And so we needed the Northerners to come in, and we would not have defeated the British in the southern part of the Revolutionary War with the help from the North. Where there was a sectional division, strangely, it wasn't over slavery. It was control of the Mississippi. It was about trade. And that's a whole other issue that we don't even think about.
Yeah. We have one more question, the last question.
Hi, I have a question about your use of the term the people, because as you just alluded to, there was the delegates to state conventions were hardly representative of most of the inhabitants of the states. So I'm wondering why you chose that term, and also I'm wondering if you found in your research anything that illuminated how people who weren't represented thought of ratification.
Yes, on all counts. Well, why the people? Well, of course, the opening words are "We the people of the United States." That comes out of the Massachusetts. They were taken from the Massachusetts Constitution, which was the first constitution to use "We the people." But this has a deep roots in English Whig thought. Locke, not because Locke is the only person, but because he's one who is often read and he's a good example.
that there were that the people had a right to overturn a government, but there were certain restrictions on it. Among the restrictions is that it had to have the support of the body of the people. So the Organization of Resistance to Britain was actually quite democratic. They tried to incorporate a good many, as many people in the resistance organizations as they could. They weren't confined to an elite. And when independence was declared, the Congress was extremely anxious to make sure that it had the support of the body of the people. They first debated independence in early June 1776, but found they were divided. And it was stated that the popular opinion was ripening fast and the states were behind the people, and that they thought if they waited a little bit, they would move toward unanimity. So they didn't take the vote until early July, and by God, they managed to get a unanimous vote. It would have been deeply split just a month before. So that seemed, it was an imperative that was in people's minds, I think, given their heritage, their English revolutionary heritage. They didn't tolerate elite revolution, and it was extremely important because it made it much more likely to succeed. You needed to have broad popular support to get through thick and thin. And then, of course, the obverse was also true. When you were creating a new government, you needed the support of the body of the people. So the idea of the sovereign people became operational, in effect. What I love about the story of the creation of the Massachusetts Constitution, which is actually in the book, I think chapter 5, is that they managed to take a theory and to transform it into a process. And that is, the towns insisted that the legislature should not write a constitution. Concord, Pittsfield, more and more towns over time said, you have to have a special election of delegates to a convention which will write a constitution and then give it back to the people. And incidentally, in Massachusetts, the people of the towns were told, voted up or down. The Massachusetts convention wasn't that stupid. The legislature tried it and the people voted it down. So what they said when they sent the Constitution out to the towns in 1780 was, you have a duty to read it carefully and to suggest where you think it should be changed. It was much more compatible with, I think, a respect for the intelligence of the people. But so does that answer your question? I mean, the people isn't something I invented. It's in the literature, and it is powerfully important concept. Now we say, what do you mean? There are no women voting, there are no Indians voting, there are no black people voting. Look, for the 18th century, to have all white males voting was, or in most states, most white votes, white males could vote, extraordinary. You know, you can't use modern standards and read them back and expect to come to any sensible conclusions, I think. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.